midst of Carmel. Who dwell in the midst of Carmel? Who dwell in the midst of Carmel? Be thy people with the rod, a flock of thy heritage. Who dwells on its hill in the wood, in the midst of Carmel? Who dwell 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 in the midst of Carmel?
Matthew 18, verse 19. Again I say unto you, then if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. The Lord's promised in this morning, where two or three are gathered together in His name, there He will be in their midst. Maybe husband and wife, parents and children, co-bonds, friends, anybody. If two or three would gather together in the name of the Lord, there the Lord would be in their midst. Today is September 1, especially a day to pray for our Carmel ministries. Every month it is chalked out that we pray and focus for one thing, and September especially we pray for our Carmel ministries, a church, a fellowship where two or three or more gathered together in His name. We are not here in any other name. We all are here in the name of Jesus. So it is the Lord's promise that He is in our midst. With this promise, I love to go to verse 11. He says, "A Son of Man is come to save that which was lost." So the Lord is in our midst. And again the Lord says, "I am come to save that which is lost." The caption for this morning meditation is, "Save that which is lost." say that which is lost. A few days back, a young man came to me. He was telling me his burden in the heart is to bring back the people, those who left the church. He said, that's my great burden, to bring back people, those who left the church. My dear brother, my dear sister, not only we have lost some people and we have to bring them back, in our lives also we lose at times many things. We might have lost that warmth of the Holy Spirit. You might have lost your prayer life. You might have lost your Bible reading, Bible study, or meditation on the Word of God. You might have lost your vibrant ministry, your testimonies. You might have lost a relationship. You might have lost a love fellowship. You might have lost something. So the Lord says, say that which is lost. He's come for that. Maybe a cordial relationship between husband and wife is lost. Maybe between the mother-in-law and the daughter-in-law is lost. Before marriage, before any marriage, we give a premarital counsel to the husband and to the wife, to the would-be husband and would-be wife. And it's really good and it's really very fruitful. But now I'm very seriously thinking. It's good to have a counsel session for the bride and the bridegroom. In that premarital counseling session, I think that we must have one session for the separately, exclusively for the mother-in-law and the daughter-in-law. What would be the role of a mother-in-law? What would be the role of a daughter-in-law? Because mostly there won't be much problem between the husband and wife if there's no problem between the mother-in-law and the daughter-in-law. Sisters must bear with me, I don't see much problem with the father-in-law and the son-in-law. Some mother-in-law become problematic because they want to pay back what they have received. The chain doesn't break. Jesus is coming of a mist to say that which was lost. He has come in our midst to save that which was lost. The Lord will answer our prayers. The Lord will bless us when we gather in His name. Whatever we ask, He will love to do it. But how to get back what we have lost? How could we be blessed? When I was reading that passage, I was able to see seven gems, seven pearls, seven beautiful things which my eyes have earlier failed to see. When I read the first four verses, at the same time came the disciples unto Jesus saying, who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? In any church, in any family, in any group, always this is the problem. Who is the greatest? Mostly, why is there a problem between husband and wife? Always the problem is, who is the greatest? Whether the husband should obey the wife, or wife should obey the husband. Whether the husband should understand the wife, or wife should understand the husband. Who should speak the last word? He will say, hey, shut up. Immediately she will say, you be quiet. Don't talk. You don't talk. And I must say the last word. It was a problem between husband and wife, who should give the last word. They went to a wise man and asked him, so this is the problem with us. Guruji, tell us, in a family, should the husband or the wife, who should have the last word? He said, of course, the husband must have the last word. The wife got, Should the husband have the last word? He said, yes. The last two words husband must say. The wife was really annoyed. He said, wait. The husband must have the last two words, and those two words must be, you are right. If the husband could say, you are right, the problem will be over. Who is the greatest? In a church, who is the greatest? Who is closer to the pastor? Who is more used in the church? My dear brother, my dear sister, the problem was also with the disciples. That is why we are unable to save that is lost. Because of this great question in our life, who is the greatest? We are unable to save that is lost in our life. So Jesus called the little child and him and set him in the midst of them, and he said, verily I say unto you, this is the key. Truly I tell you, husband and wife, mother-in-law, daughter-in-law, you can't save that is lost. You can't save a lost relationship. You can't save a lost love. You can't save your lost prayer life. Verily I tell you, truly I tell you. In other words, Jesus said, I promise and tell you, you can't, it's impossible, except ye be converted and become as little children. Mother-in-law, unless you are converted, there can be no peace in your family. You don't blame your daughter-in-law, don't blame your son, you don't blame anybody. The mother-in-law is to be converted. The daughter-in-law is to be converted. That husband is to be converted. That wife is to be converted. That believer in the church is to be converted. That teacher must be, that sister must be converted. Except you be converted, you cannot save that is lost. I may be a preacher. I may be a pastor. If I want to save that is lost, except I be converted, I cannot save a lost relationship. Suppose there is a problem between me and another pastor, or between me and another believer. How can I save that is lost? Except I be converted and become as little children, you shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. I promise you cannot enter into the kingdom of heaven except you be converted. What is the kingdom of heaven? Kingdom of heaven is not eating and drinking. It is peace, righteousness, and the joy of the Holy Ghost. It is peace, righteousness, and the joy of the Holy Ghost. Brother, sister, pati tata, amma appa, pastor, preacher, worship leader, Sunday school teacher, except you be converted, you shall not enter into peace, righteousness, and the joy of the Holy Ghost. Mother-in-law, daughter-in-law, I don't know, it's coming in my mind again and again. God willing, before I could solemnize, I want to materialize this. A premarital counseling session for the daughter-in-law and the mother-in-law. Because I see many families, there's no problem between husband and wife. The problem between the mother-in-law and the daughter-in-law. I heard with my own eye, yes. That is the father-in-law saying, see, I don't have any problem. If my wife and my son's wife, if they go together, I am happy. Unless we are converted. What is that conversion? Verse 4. Whosoever therefore shall humble himself as this little child, the same is greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Can you tell me what is the kingdom of heaven? I don't hear you. Peace, righteousness, joy of the Holy Ghost. Can you repeat? What is the kingdom of heaven? Peace, righteousness, joy of the Holy Ghost. Now who will be greatest in peace? Who will be greatest in righteousness? Who will be greatest in joy of the Holy Ghost? Mother-in-law or daughter-in-law? Husband or wife? Who will be greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Who will be greatest in the joy of the Holy Ghost? Mother-in-law or daughter-in-law? Can you tell me? It's very clear. Read. Whosoever therefore shall humble himself as this little child, the same is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Now who will be greatest in peace? I don't hear you. He that humbles himself as this little child. Who will be greatest in the joy of the Holy Ghost? He that humbles himself like this little child. Who will be greatest in righteousness? He that humbles himself like a little child. So many a time we are unable to save that is lost. Jesus said, I am come to save that is lost. He called one particular little child, and showing this little child, he was explaining. If you want to be the greatest, if the husband wants to be the greatest, what I say you should obey. That can't be achieved by pride. If you want to be the greatest, I tell the husband, you humble yourself. Why, if you want to score a point in your argument, verily I tell you, truly I tell you, except you be converted and humble yourself, you cannot win that argument. You cannot save that is lost. God cannot be in your midst. It can be in a church, it can be a mother-in-law, daughter-in-law, husband, wife, annan, thambi, whosoever it may be. We need this nature. I humble. I yield. I give up. Then you will become the greatest. If you believe the word of God is true, this is the truth. How can we save that is lost? How can we save that is lost? Number two. I'm taking the seven pearls from the same passage. Verse 5. And whoso shall receive one such little child in my name, receiveth me. I call this hospitality. Somebody weak, somebody innocent, somebody make a prank, somebody make a mistake. A little child will do all these things. A little child will surely make a prank. A little child will very frankly speak something, very innocently speak something. A little child may break a china ware. A little child will do a lot of foolish things. A little child cannot obey us like a matured person will obey. The second thing Jesus says, we want to save that is lost, receive a little child like this, accept. I call that hospitality. There is a beautiful hymn we all love to sing, just as I am without one plea, I come to thee. Just as I am. We love the little child. Not because the child is very intelligent, not because the child doesn't make any mistakes. When we go nearer to that child, the child may kick us. When some parents, they bring their children, the child will stamp on my foot. Oh, don't, the child doesn't make much difference. It is the foot of a pastor, or it is the foot of somebody else. The child will stamp on our feet. When we do some dedication service, interesting things would take place. At times the child would even wet our dress. Will we hit a child for that? Will we hit a child for that? Oh, you wet my dress. My dear brother, my dear sister, you receive your mother-in-law like that. You receive a husband like that. You receive your wife like that. And those who shall receive one such little child in my name receiveth me. Like receiving a child, receive somebody else. Jesus has accepted us with all our mistakes. Jesus has not received us because we are very goody-goody people. We are His enemies. We have done many things which would hurt the heart of Jesus, but He has received us. Receive one another like that. Show hospitality. There is a beautiful Thirukural. Mopa kulayum anicha mugan thirindu noka kulayum virindu. Mopa kulayum anicha. There is a flower called anichampu. Even if you smell it, that will shrink. Even when you need not touch it, just smell it, that will shrink. So sensitive. That called anicham. Mope kulayum anicham. Mugam thirindu noka kulayum virindu. Don't show a frowned face at somebody else. They will be fainting. They will be broken. Your daughter-in-law has come home. New environment. Receive her. Let not your look make her faint. Your husband is coming home tired. Your very look, how you receive him, make him fresh. There are some women, they open the door, even don't look at his face, because their TV program is going on or something is in the stove. They don't even say, hello, how are you? Not even a smile. They don't even just, as a gesture, take that back from his hand. They show their back and go. They don't receive the bag, they show their back and go. He will be broken. He will be broken. How you receive one another? How do you show your face to one another? How do you make others comfortable in your presence? The very look at your wife in the church, A newcomer is come. A newcomer. Just smile at him. What that you are going to lose? It's very much lacking in our church. It's very much lacking in our church. They don't say hello to one another. They all just go and meet their friends. All through 7 days they spoke over the phone. And what is left, they come here and continue. It's horrible. Receive this little one. You will save that is lost. You will save that is lost. So it is not only humility. The second pearl that I want to bring to your attention to save that is lost, a prayer, a Bible reading, a love, a fellowship, or anything to save that is lost, show hospitality. To show that face to your daughter-in-law, you will gain her. To show that face to your mother-in-law, you will gain her. To show that face to your husband, your wife, your children, you will gain them. Receive them. Receive them as they are. It is not that I will receive them only if they match to my standard. No, receive them as they are. Jesus never said, I will receive you only when you come to my standard. Jesus has received me just as I am, without one plea. Even when you don't find any one thing that is acceptable in your standard, you are very high, praise God. You got a very high standard of life, praise God. You are God-like, you don't have any mistake in your life, praise God. You are the embodiment of virtue, praise God. Sister, brother, there's nobody like you, none beside thee. You're equal to God, praise God. But receive the other person as he is. Receive the other person as he is. Don't say, oh, only when you be like me. Praise God, that person is not like you. If that person also becomes like you, then both 120 kilos boxing. Thank God you are 120 and that person is only 60. If that person also becomes like you, both heavyweight fighting. All horrible things. That is why we are unable to gain what is lost. Jesus said, I am come to save which is lost. My dear brother, my dear sister, from 7 January I am preaching. I read this passage many a time. But yesterday it was new to me. How can I save that is lost? When I know to receive others as they are. I can go on and on and on. And number 3. I read from verse 6. But whoso shall offend one of these little ones which believe in me, it were better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck and that he were drowned in the depth of the sea. Woe unto the world because of offenses. Woe unto the world because of offenses. Woe unto that family because of offenses. Woe unto that husband because of offenses. Woe unto that wife because of offenses. Woe unto that mother-in-law because of offenses. Woe unto the daughter-in-law because of offenses. Woe unto the pastors because of offenses. Woe unto the believers because of offenses. On the first morning, am I causing curses? I am reading the Bible text. Woe unto the world because of offenses. For it must needs be that offenses come. It's good. Offenses come. But woe unto that man or that woman by whom the offense cometh. Whosoever, if thy hand of thy foot offend thee, cut them off and cast them from thee. It is better for thee to enter into the life halt or maimed, rather than having two hands or two feet to be cast into the everlasting fire. And if thine eye offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee. It is better for thee to enter into life with one eye, rather than having two eyes to be cast into hell fire. There was an atheist by name Ingersoll. Somebody asked Ingersoll, how did he become an atheist? How did he become an atheist? He said, because of my Sunday school teacher. Because of my Sunday school teacher. It must needs be that offense has come. It must needs be that offense has come. Only these things make us grow. But woe unto that man by whom the offense cometh. By whom that offense cometh. If your eye offend you, it is better you pluck that eye and throw it away. You can enter life with one eye. How can one eye alone offend me? If my eye offend me, both the eyes must offend me. How can I say only one eye offend me? My one eye doesn't offend me, but one who offends, bringing in offense, is a very serious matter. It is better that person is totally plucked off. It is better that person is not in our midst. I made this mistake earlier. When I know that it is the offense is coming because of one man, even when the Lord showed me about that man in a vision, I was not willing to pluck that and throw it away. I was making that man more important. It was spreading. Only when that man who was bringing in offense was removed, the sea became calm. Because the man who brings in offense is a very big nuisance. It's not that one hand will bring offense, not the other hand. That I can steal only with the right hand, it's not that I can't steal with the left hand. I never understood this passage very carefully. My dear brother, my dear sister, it's a very serious problem. How many children go astray because of the fathers? How many children go astray because of the mothers? If my sons, he would become a drug addict because of my husband. What is important? It doesn't mean literally throw their husband away, but it is as serious as that. He is bringing in offense because of my wife. Always fights with me, bickering, selfish, very possessive. Because of her, my children will be offended. I don't say throw her out, but it's as serious like that. That one eye, be
because of that mother-in-law carrying the Bible, going to the church, doing the ministry, and she doesn't show the life of Christian love, and because of that, if the daughter-in-law is offended, pluck that eye off. It is that serious. We who bear the witness for Christ, I pastor, if my son, my daughter, my son-in-law, my daughter-in-law, grandchildren, if they could be offended in following Christ because what I do, it is better that I am plucked off. I know two families, they were attending a church earlier. The love of Christ in them is abundant. The love for servants of God is very abundant in them. But they could not grow in a spiritual atmosphere because they were offended by a servant of God. They were offended by a servant of God. It must needs be that offenses come. One boy, one family is not coming to our church. He said, what's the problem? No, I don't want to see that family. I don't want to see that brother. If I see them, I lose my peace. I don't want to come here. I want to go to a place where I don't know anybody. It must needs be that offenses come. But if a person is offended because of you, it is better a millstone, a big boulder, it tied around your neck and drowned in a sea. My dear brother, my dear sister, number three, I say, our Christian honesty is very, very important. Not just honesty, a Christian honesty. Our word, our behavior, nothing should be against Christian love, Christian principles. When our speaking, our doing are different, what is a Lord Pastor? எல்லாம் ஒரு பாஸ்டரமாவா? எல்லாம் ஊழியம் செய்கிறாங்களா? பீப்புள் கெட் அஃபெண்டட், காசிங் அஃபென்ஸ் இன் த லைஃப் ஆஃப் அதர்ஸ் இஸ் அ வெரி சீரியஸ் மேட்டர். மை டியர் பிரதர், மை டியர் சிஸ்டர், maybe your daughter-in-law, just illustration, not from a Pentecostal background, a spiritual background, CSI, a Roman Catholic, a Hindu or an atheist, how are we going to win that girl to the Lord? If our very life is not exhibiting Christ to that person, if the anointing that rests upon us does not bear witness for Christ, the anointing should bear witness for Christ. And if our very life is an offense for her, I tell you, mother-in-law, father-in-law, it's better a millstone is tied around your neck and be drowned in a mid-sea. It is very serious. Let our life be filled with honesty. I call that honesty a Christian honesty. It is not that I don't speak like, it is not that I don't rob, it is not that I just don't sleep with somebody else. No, that, no, I'm not talking about that honesty. Living to the Word of God. Living to the Word of God. That can save that which is lost. Please don't think it's a very serious topic. But I said it's a very beautiful topic. Number four, I want to read from verse 10. Take heed that you despise not one of these little ones. For I say unto you that in heaven their angels do always behold the face in my Father which is in heaven. For the Son of Man is come to save that which is lost. How think ye? If a man have 100 sheep, and one of them be gone astray, doth he not leave the 99, and goeth into the mountains, and seeketh that which is gone astray? And if so be that he find it, verily I say unto you, he rejoiceth more of that sheep than of the 99 which went not astray. Even the will of your Father which is in heaven, that one of these little ones should perish. So it is not the will of your Father which is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish. My dear brother, my dear sister, despise not others. Despise not others. Don't estimate others low. I mean, it's a message to me. What is that little child? It's a child that goes astray, not fitting into your principles, not fitting into your discipline, not satisfied with your posture. It goes astray. It goes out of the way. Will you leave like that? Pona potom. My dear brother, my dear sister, like that father with love and affection, at times we have to wait for the child to come back. But this is not a child. This is a dumb sheep. Foolish. Over enthusiastic. Hyper. Just ran away. You want to save that is lost. Don't worry about these 99, those are with you. Go back to that one sheep, one lamb, that gone astray. You have to climb the mountain. Very difficult. You are very tired, you are very weary. Okay. Gone means gone, okay. I don't mind. Somebody's wife left. I'm sorry to say this. They said, "Oh, your wife left you." Very coolly that person, "Oh, so what? If I phone any call taxi will come. If I phone any call taxi will come." What a mentality is that? I got 99 sheep. Why should I worry about that one sheep? One lamb? But there is a master we know. He's more worried about that one sheep. I don't know whether a shepherd will do like that or not. I don't know. Here I see in this story the picture of a shepherd. I don't see him as very wise. What will happen to these 99 sheep? Them alone and go. Will they not get scattered? I don't know, he has got some under shepherd to take care of them. Then he could have sent this under shepherd to look for this one. I said, Lord, I don't see it's very wise. Leaving this 99 in Lurk and going for one. The Lord tells me, what seems to be foolish in your sight, it is wise in the sight of God. In this story, what the highlight is, even at the risk of losing 99, that foolish love, that blind love, is for that one that is lost, for that one that went astray, for that one who is disobedient, for that one who is not falling in our principle, that one who doesn't listen to me. It doesn't mean that I'm not worried about this 99. The underlying factor is, I'm more worried about that. My dear brother, my dear sister, when we could show this honor to somebody who goes astray. Very paradoxical, but this is a fact. When you show honor to somebody that goes astray, we don't give honor to one who goes astray. We give honor only to the 99 who are with us. That's why we lose. We could not save that is lost. Don't despise one that is lost. Don't despise somebody who has gone astray. Don't think those who are with me are grain and those who are gone out are chaff. Those who are with me are grains. Those who are gone out are chaff. My dear brother, my dear sister, even in the ministry, I have lost some loved ones. At times it may be my mistake. At times it because they have gone astray. At times it may be because the problem between cattle and cattle. But those are very close with me, they know very well. I never despised one person that has left me. Always I feel, oh, I missed him. I missed that family. How much they were helping me. How much they were close to me. Even today I'd be happy if I could win them back. At times, we go behind them, we bring them back. At times we have to take a broom and sweep the floor to get the lost coin. At times we have to wait like that loving father for them to come back. Somebody has left the church for a few years. Hundreds of people come in. When I see their faces, I'm happy. But when that one family which has left the church coming back, when I see them, the joy in me is more. So you think that you can go and come back, so I'll be more happy? It is not that. This is the heart of a shepherd. My dear brother, my dear sister, don't despise those who go astray. If you want to save that is lost in your family, when somebody doesn't fit in your rules and regulations, your lines, your framework, they go astray, don't despise them. Your daughter is not listening to you. She wants to have her own way. Don't despise her. It doesn't mean that you can leave them without discipline. Bring them into discipline. Bring them into discipline. But don't despise them because of their sin, because of their behavior, because they backhand, because they don't fit in with your frame. Don't despise them. I can go for a long time on one point. We go to verse 15. Moreover, if thy brother shall trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. If he shall hear thee, thou hast gained thy brother. But he will not hear thee, then take thee one or two more, that in the mouth of two or three witnesses every word may be established. And if shall neglect to hear thee, let it tell it unto the church. But if he neglect to hear the church, let him be unto thee an heathen man and publican. When I was reading that earlier, even this was a little rude to me. But I could not see there's no other option than this. When somebody has done wronged you, go and talk to him. You want to gain him. Don't make it public. Don't go and tell others. When he is alone, you go personally. Probably take a gift with you and tell him, this is the problem. This is what I don't like. Go and talk to him alone. If he doesn't hear you, take somebody with you whom he would listen to. Because your objective is to gain him. Even then he doesn't listen to it, you tell the priests, pastors, they could go and talk to him. They would be able to show unto him from the word of God, this is what the Bible says, this is what the law of Moses says, this is what the law of Christ says, this is the law of the Spirit. They will tell him. If you are wrong, they will tell you, because now it has been made public. So if it is wrong, the pastor will tell you, according to the Bible you are wrong, or according to the Bible he is wrong. And if he doesn't listen to even the church, he will be like a heathen or a publican. I thought what the Lord says. So from that moment he will be untouchable to you, like a heathen or a publican. He is cast out from that movement. The Lord said, no, it's not that. The complaint about Jesus was, he feasted with the heathens and publicans. The complaint about Jesus was, he was going to the house of heathens and publicans. He is not listening to you, you are unable to establish the old relationship. But the Lord told me yesterday, don't cut off the relation, cut off the fellowship. Love him. You don't have a relationship, love him. That son has left your family, love that son. The daughter-in-law has gone away, love her. As a heathen, as a publican to Jesus. Even when this person becomes a heathen, a publican, left your family, left your clan, visit them. Keep the doors open. For a Pharisee, visiting a heathen is anathema. For a Pharisee, a publican is untouchable. For a Pharisee, dining with a heathen or a publican, unimaginable. Your mother-in-law is like a heathen to you. Your mother-in-law is like a publican to you. Your son, your daughter-in-law, you are another believer. Somebody has harmed you terribly. They have become like a heathen to you. If you are a Pharisee, you will not go to his house. If you are a Christian, you will go to his house. Now a question whether you are a Pharisee or a Christian. Now it's a question whether you are a Pharisee or a Christian. It is true your son has become a heathen to you. He totally disobeyed you. He has chosen his own way. He has broken his heart. He said, no more, I am your son. He left your house. It is true, he has become a heathen to you. But now, he is a heathen to you. Are you a Pharisee or a Christian? The point is, I must gain him. I must gain her. Jesus came to save which was lost. I never heard this message in my life earlier. I never read this in a book. I never preached that earlier. The Spirit of the Lord revealed these secrets to me. I call this hugging. A hugging. Gaining somebody that is lost. Gaining someone who is lost. Number 6, verse 19. Again I say unto you, that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. I call this haughty. Be one mind. If you can apply all these principles, if you can humble, if you can receive a erring person, if you have got a heart to search for him, if you have got a heart to honor somebody who has gone astray, if you have got a heart to hug the person who has offended you, if you have got all these natures, getting this one mind, a hearty relationship, it is not impossible. A haughty relationship is not impossible. Be one-minded. Before you pray together, be one-minded. Let our life be filled with love. Be one-minded. My dear brother, my dear sister, Jesus came to save that is lost. And how could that be possible when he cannot give his heart to me? If he can't receive me as I am, how can I be one with him? If he cannot take the pain to climb the mountain to search for me, how can he and I be one? When we become one mind, agree on earth as touching anything. The spirit of agreement. I agree with you in Christ. In Christ. I agree with you. Unless there is this agreement, agreeing to one another, we can never say that is lost. And finally, I said honesty, haughty, hospitality, humility, etc., etc., etc. I want to choose a word that could make us easy to remember. But not I, the Spirit of the Lord gave me this word, heavenly. Be heavenly minded. Verse 21 to 35. The simple truth. Jesus said, forgive one another. Forgive the wrongs others have done you. Just forgive. How many times the Jews, they believe this forgiveness. They suggested, even somebody makes a mistake 7 times, if he repents, forgive him. You know why the Jews said like that? Even just shall fall 7 times. Neethiman yelu tharam viduva. Even the just shall fall 7 times. So somebody can make mistake 7 times. He may be a just man. He has fallen.
A good husband, he has done something wrong. A good wife, she spoke like that. She is a good wife. She can make mistakes 7 times. She will rise up. Even if he falls 7 times, he will arise. So just forgive. So in one occasion, Luke 17:4, almost the same context, Jesus said, forgive them 7 times. Forgive them 7 times. The letter kills, the spirit quickeneth. Jesus said, forgive them 7 times. Immediately Peter asked a question, Lord, how oft shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Till 7 times? So 8th time I'll kill him. I'll forgive 7 times because the law says. Because Jesus himself said 7 times. I'll forgive him 7 times. And the 8th time he makes an offense, I'll kill him. Jesus said, no, 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 not like that. I say not unto thee, Peter, don't mistake me. I told you 7 times. But Peter, I didn't mean that. What is it? Many times we misunderstand the word of God. I say not unto thee until 7 times. But what I meant, until 70 times 7, literally in a day. Because that was a Jewish custom. You can forgive somebody for 7 times in a day. The highest. Jesus said 70 times 7 in a day. So now somebody could say, okay, I'll count 490 times. When he makes the mistake 490 first time, I'll kill him. It's not the letter, it's the spirit. But when you forgive him, what did Jesus said? For that passage, you go to Luke chapter 17, verse 4. And if he trespass against thee 7 times in a day, and 7 times in a day turn again to thee, saying, I repent, thou shalt forgive him. So 490 times, he'll turn again, come to you and say, I am sorry. I am sorry. So you count 1. Second time, I am sorry. Third time, in a day, 490 times he say, I am sorry. But some people even, they don't say praise the Lord. They do some mistake, as soon as they see me, sorry pastor. The greeting itself is sorry pastor. Sorry, yeah. And waiting outside, they'll be coming little late. They don't say praise Lord pastor, hello pastor, good morning pastor. As soon as they say, sorry pastor. So, day by day I'm becoming sorry pastor. My dear brother, my dear sister. Whatever they have done, a heart to forgive them. God has forgiven so many things in our lives. Why can't we forgive others? There is a spiritual principle in forgiving others. When somebody has wronged me, in Mark 11 it's very clear. When I stand and pray, I forgive him. When he asks forgiveness, he gets the benefit of my forgiveness. When he asks pardon, he gets the benefit of my forgiveness. So it is not necessary that he should come and tell me I'm sorry. I should forgive him. I should take that away from my heart when I stand and pray. I should take that away from my heart when I stand and pray. If I have hurt somebody, I should say, go and reconcile with him. That Matthew chapter 5. There are 2 things. If I have offended somebody,
If somebody has got a hurt because of me, somebody has got an ought against me, I should go and reconcile. I should go and talk. If somebody has offended me, if I got an ought against somebody, I should forgive. He comes to me or not, I should forgive. Nobody asked, Jesus, forgive me at the foot of Calvary. Jesus said, Father, forgive them. Not only you forgive that person, you pray that God would forgive that person. But when he turns again and comes to you and say, I'm sorry, he reaps the benefit of your forgiveness and the forgiveness of God. And if you say in your heart, I cannot forgive my wife, I cannot forgive my husband, no, I cannot take that out of my heart. I cannot take it out of my heart what my wife said. I cannot take it out of my heart what that believer said. My dear brother, my dear sister, I pity for you. If you cannot forgive that person, the word of God says, your Father in heaven will not forgive your trespasses. Where all you have offended the Lord, where all you have offended the Lord will not forgive you. So likewise, shall my heavenly Father do also unto you, if you from your hearts forgive not everyone his brother their trespasses. They have trespassed. In trespass, the Tamil is a beautiful word, Atthumiri. Crossing the level. Crossing the level. Your husband has spoken to you, crossing the boundary. Your wife has behaved to you, crossing the levels. That's trespass, passed over. Your boss, your pastor, your daughter-in-law, son-in-law, mother-in-law, somebody has trespassed. They cross the limits. Sister, this is a blessed message to you. If you can forgive their trespass, your heavenly Father will forgive your trespasses. It's a good news for you. It's a good news for you. It's a good news for you. If you can forgive somebody who has trespassed in your life, your heavenly Father will surely forgive where you have trespassed him. I finish with this caution note. If you cannot forgive from your heart, Matthew 18:15. If you from your heart forgive not everyone his brother that trespasses, if you from your heart cannot forgive that person who has trespassed in your life, I love to tell you the fact, God cannot forgive you. There are certain things the Almighty God cannot do. There are certain things even the Almighty God cannot do. Let me tell you one more time. There are certain things the Almighty God cannot do. He's not making a square into a circle. A square is a square. A circle is a circle. One thing the Almighty God cannot do, He cannot forgive those who cannot forgive others. It is impossible for God to do it. It is impossible for God to do it. If you cannot forgive, God cannot forgive. If you cannot forgive somebody who has trespassed you from your heart, I tell you in the name of Jesus, God cannot forgive that forgive you. It's impossible with God. It's impossible with God. Even the blood of Jesus Christ pleading for the sinners cannot bring forgiveness for those who cannot forgive others. Is not that blood all powerful? That blood cannot bring you a forgiveness. It's a very serious matter. Jesus has come to say that which is lost. If you can agree touching anything, one-hearted, it is God's promise to you. He will be in your midst to grant unto you your request. Take a decision. Give me the grace to save that is lost. Stand to your feet. Dear Father God, give me the grace, O Lord. Give your grace to every one of us, O Master God. That we be able to save that which is lost. In the church, in the family, Lord, give every one of us a heart to agree with others in you. That you would be in our midst and grant unto us the desires of our heart. Bless your people. Send them back home with your heavenly benediction. In Jesus' name.